Dearly beloved, family and friends, we are gathered together today to remember the life of John Michael Fox, who died in April after a valiant battle with metastasized cancer. I deeply appreciate all of you who have traveled from near and far to support John's wife, Lee, and their extended network of family and friends during this time of mourning. I'm Reverend Katie Scudera, and I am the lead minister here at First Parish in Needham Unitarian Universalist. I heartily welcome all of you to our sanctuary and to our live stream. We are honored to host John's memorial service and reception, and delighted to have our guest pianist, Mary Jane Rupert, with us today to offer some of John's favorite pieces of music, including Chopin's Nocturnes. Thank you all for keeping your masks on for the duration of the service, except when you're speaking. Per John's family wishes, as a mitzvah, to protect those who are still vulnerable to COVID-19 and other infectious diseases. Please remember that John's family welcomes those of you who are here in Needham to a reception in our parish hall immediately following the service. We hope that this service will capture John's spirit and his life as a devoted husband, brother, nephew, cousin, uncle, and friend, a musician, a traveler, and a sailor, and a lifelong learner and educator. Thank you all for being here, and again, welcome one and all. I now invite forward Lynn Newman, John's sister-in-law, to share our opening words from Reformed Jewish Rabbi Alvin Fine.
Good morning. We come together this morning to honor John, to pay tribute to his life's journey, a journey that has touched us all. Birth is a beginning and death a destination, but life is a journey, a going, a growing from stage to stage, from childhood to maturity and youth to age, from innocence to awareness and ignorance to knowing, from foolishness to discretion, and then perhaps to wisdom, from weakness to strength, or strength to weakness, and often back again, from health to sickness, and back we pray to better health, from offense to forgiveness, and loneliness to love, from joy to gratitude, from pain to compassion, and grief to understanding, from fear to faith, from defeat to defeat, and to defeat again, and to looking backward or ahead, we see that victory lies not on some high place along the way, but in having made the journey, stage by stage, a sacred pilgrimage. Birth is a beginning, and death the destination, but life is the journey, a sacred pilgrimage made stage by stage, from birth to death, to life everlasting.
Thank you, Lynn. I now invite you into a time of prayer and reflection with these words adapted from Unitarian Universalist minister, Reverend Patricia Sheldon, so that we may center ourselves on this precious present moment, remembering John. Please take a deep breath and settle comfortably wherever you are seated. In this hour of stillness, we gather to honor the life and the person we love. In this hour of stillness, we remind ourselves that the flame of life and love are never fully extinguished. In this hour of stillness, we offer ourselves for sharing the weight of each other's grief. In this hour of stillness, we offer the strength of our love to help others survive their pain and grief. In this hour of stillness, we call forth from each of us the power we offer out of life, out of loss, and out of love. Amen. John Michael Fox was born on September 6, 1952, the elder of eventually two sons for Wallace Wally Fox and Marjorie Anderson Fox. John could have been named something other than John, but before he was born, Wally, at the time called Mickey, made a bet with a friend over whether the baby would be a girl or a boy. Wally lost that bet to his friend, who was named John. Throughout his childhood, though, John was called by his middle nickname, Mike. His father, Wally, had grown up during the Depression, the youngest of eight siblings whose father died when Wally was 10. Wally served in the Navy in World War II and was deployed in the Pacific Theater on an electronic squadron. Wally and Marjorie got married right after he returned home, and with his military training and experience, Wally built a successful career as a radio operator for the Indianapolis Police Department. Marjorie worked as well for the local phone company, and both were part of the Masonic movement as a Freemason and an Eastern Star. As their relatives put it to me, the Fox and Anderson families were all manufactured in Indiana, where many of John's extended family members still live. And so John's childhood was full of family. The Foxes lived in a home built by Wally on 34th Street in Indianapolis, not far from where Wally grew up and conveniently located next door to Marjorie's parents, Grandma Ethel and Grandpa Ralph. John also got to see his paternal grandmother, Nellie, regularly. John's maternal Uncle Jack and his maternal aunt Patty were also in Indianapolis, and his Uncle Jack had three boys, Ronnie, Bobby, and Denny, and later a fourth, Shane, who were born not long after John and his brother David, who arrived in 1954. This meant that while Marjorie and Wally were at work, John and David would be cared for by Grandma Ethel next door, who was also still raising Marjorie's two youngest sisters, Janet and Linda, who were only 13 and 3 years older than their nephew. And she often cared for Jack's sons, too. Later, Janet got married and added another boy to the mix, John's cousin Wayne. Which is all to say, poor Ethel. And poor, poor Aunt Linda. Though technically an aunt to John, David, Ronnie, Bobby, Denny, and Wayne, she functioned more as an elder sister to this gaggle of boys. As Linda told me, we loved like siblings and we fought like siblings. Linda also told me that she once said to her father, Ralph, well, if all they're gonna have is boys, you might as well buy me a set of guns. Indeed, her father then bought her two toy guns and an Annie Oakley outfit. Fortunately for Linda, her big brother Jack eventually had Cindy and her big sister Janet, Donna. Donna remembers that it was John who first taught her the early piano student classic, Chopsticks. And all this time over at Grandma Ethel's home did not mean that John was deprived of time with his parents. Marjorie nurtured his intellectual spirit, regularly taking him to the library, and encouraged his interest in music, and introduced him to spirituality and religion, taking the family to church every Sunday. Wally taught John fishing, hunting, and handyman skills. John's childhood was simply full of family in a very joyous way. His whole life, he was committed to spend Christmas with everyone in his family who he could, after a childhood of wonderful holiday gatherings with both his paternal and maternal sides of the family. There were many wonderful parts of John's early childhood. John excelled at school with a natural curiosity and strong intellect. One of his prized toys as a child was a microscope. And it was as though he was always wondering, what can I read next? What can I learn next? He began playing piano, which would become a lifelong avocation. And he would go camping with David and Linda and at least one of their sets of parents at a time. Wally and Marjorie would also take the trio to the movies, though it sounded like they argued about which movies they would go see. And he had a beloved dog named Pooch, who even when the family tried to rehome Pooch, that dog came running back across Indianapolis to his boy, John. John and Pooch would often go out into the woods near 34th Street and spend the day out in nature, cooking a can of soup over a fire for lunch. John would continue to keep pets, cats, into his adulthood. John was always a very good boy, a golden boy. Though he was often with his brother and cousins, John would sort of disappear whenever they were about to do something against the rules. He would neither participate nor tattle. It was after the Foxes moved from 34th Street to Goldenrod Drive that John was in seventh grade, that John requested he not be called Mike anymore. This was but one of many changes the move to Goldenrod and the start of John's teenage years incited. While he stayed quite close to family, his social circle became larger than it had ever been before. His priority was always his academic success, yet John was also very athletic, playing on the high school football team. He was in a rock band, on piano and guitar, and he was so popular that he was voted class king. John graduated from high school in 1970. He had been offered a full-ride athletic scholarship to one college, but he had that strong sense of his priorities. He knew he wouldn't become a professional athlete, and he wanted to focus on his studies. So instead, John began his bachelor's in logic and philosophy at Indiana University in Bloomington. When John was a senior, he lived in an apartment with two other men, and they felt very lucky when a group of four women moved in next door. One of these women was Lee Newman, another Indiana native who was a senior studying political science and sociology, and who was sharing a room with her younger sister, Lynn, a sophomore. Lee said that it was love at first sight with John. Lynn even remembers when they first met John and how quickly and totally he and Lee fell in love with each other. The fact that John and Lee essentially moved in together was also a boon to Lynn, who then had a room for herself in the women's apartment. Lee and John were 21 years old when they met and were inseparable for the rest of his life, nearly 50 years. They had so much in common, and not just that they were both Hoosiers. They were both brilliant, curious, and ambitious. They both loved music. Because John was taking piano and violin at IU, John could take Lee to the music school's practice rooms so they could both enjoy playing and listening to the grand pianos. And they were regular concert goers their whole life together. They both loved the outdoors, with John a tad more adventurous, encouraging Lee outside her comfort zone. And they had dreams of traveling, which they would get to do together. They were a tight dyad, completely in love and in awe of each other. They knew how lucky they were to have found their soul's mate at such a young age. John and Lee surmounted two early challenges in their lifelong partnership. First, they were both graduating from IU and both wanted to go to graduate school, but fortunately, they were both admitted into prestigious programs in Greater Boston, John to MIT for philosophy and formal mathematics, and after a stint on a planning board near her hometown, Lee to Boston University in urban planning. Second, John's mother was showing signs of serious illness by the time Lee came into the picture. Marjorie had a congenital heart defect and had had rheumatic fever as a child, both of which affected her for the rest of her life. Marjorie died in 1975 when she was only 46 and John was only 23. A very hard loss, especially with him living and studying far from family at the time. His brother David, then only 21, entered a challenging period while grieving his mother. Though David married his high school sweetheart and had a son, Aaron, born in 1976, he and his sweetheart soon divorced. David's life was rocky for quite a while, and John remained connected and supportive of his brother until he came out of this difficult stage. John and Lee were deeply committed to each other and for their careers to be meaningful and successful. Both John and Lee would eventually graduate from MIT, him with his PhD and her with her master's. and they settled in Lincoln, Massachusetts. John's career began as an instructor in MIT's mathematics department in 1983, but truly launched when he joined Northeastern University's mathematics department in 1986. By some professorial happenstance, John ended up taking on computer science courses. And after John took over the programming course, he grew the enrollment from 25 to 150, and then formally moved into the computer science field. John was an excellent and extremely well-loved educator in his decade as a professor. John left academia in 1993 for Smart Software Incorporated, first hired to take their software package from a DOS to a Windows platform, and then becoming the chief programming architect for their forecasting and statistical data analysis software. He'd stay with Smart Software for nearly 20 years, working with a diverse set of companies, including huge Fortune 500 ones like Abbott Laboratories, Purdue Pharma, Monsanto, Siemens, and Thermo Fisher Scientific. John received numerous awards for his software development work, including in 2007, the prestigious Association for Supply Chain Management's Technology Partnership Award of Innovative Excellence. John and Lee developed a strong circle of friends in Greater Boston through their work and through their hobbies. In addition to their love of music and hiking, these Midwesterners grew to love outdoor activities common to New England, sailing and skiing. When John learned something new, he dove in deep and he became a skilled skier and sailor. John loved bringing the people he loved together, and so he became the organizer for group trips for both of these activities, ski trips to northern New England and sailing adventures up the Maine coastline and around the Cape, and sometimes even farther afield, planning sailing flotillas in the Caribbean. Together and with friends, John and Lee traveled to Europe, the United Kingdom, Germany, France, the latter of which where they would visit Lee's old work colleague, Sandrine, with whom John loved to play duets, him on piano and she on flute. But like when he was in high school, neither John's professional successes nor his social circle would distance him from his and Lee's families. They would travel back to Indiana, at least for the holidays each year, especially to join in on the fun of Christmas Eve with all of John's aunts, uncles, and cousins. Both of Lee's sisters had settled in Chicago, so they were frequent flyers there as well. Lee's sister, Lynn, and her partner, Vernon, were part of John's extended network of sailing crewmates. And if there were a Fox or Newman family health crisis back home, John would hop on a plane to go help. Busy as he was with his career and with his hobbies, John was not so busy that he wasn't there for his family when they needed him. This included bringing family out to Massachusetts, too. Many family members from points west would visit, but John's focus was on his nephew, Aaron, with whom John was determined to maintain a relationship after Aaron and his mom moved out of Indianapolis. John invited Aaron to visit Boston, and John made it worth his while, driving up the coast to buy fresh lobster, windsurfing out on the ocean, Sox games at Fenway Park, and introducing him to the guitar and to computer science. When Aaron was going through a bit of a punk kid phase in his teenage years, John took him out skateboarding, one should say, in Quincy Market. Through John's tenacious love and Aaron's openness, they grew a special bond. Aaron ended up visiting his cool Uncle John nearly every summer and remembers his uncle as a loving and engaged father figure, always interested in Aaron's interests and proud of his accomplishments. John was first diagnosed with ampullary cancer in 2003. He was unable to go to Indiana for the first time for the holidays, and his dad, aunts, brother, and cousin Wayne instead visited him and Lee in Lincoln for Thanksgiving and Christmas. John's cancer was, for a long while, successfully treated with a surgery. He was followed for 5 years after the surgery when he was declared in remission, and during which time he and Lee moved into their home in Concord. And by 2008, other family members' health became John's concern. His father had a stroke, and shortly thereafter, Wally's second wife, Viola Brown, died. So John moved his father to Boston and coordinated his care until Wally's death in 2017. John offered the same kind of attentive care management to Lee's mother, who fell and broke her hip in 2005. John and Lee first welcomed her into their home in Concord to get her healthy and settled before she moved into North Hill, not far from Lee's work with Needham Town Government. Sadly, John's brother David, who had inherited their mother's congenital heart defect and had also had rheumatic fever as a child, died in 2011 when he was just 57 years old. After that hard period beginning with their mother's death in 1975, David had built a good life for himself, finishing college, settling in Arizona, working in both construction and counseling, marrying a widow and a mother of four, and mending his relationship with his own son, Aaron. Both John and David were present for Aaron's wedding in 2007. David's death was another huge loss for the extended Fox family. And that same year that David died, John left Smart Software to found his own company, Datamorphics, which offered consulting services in data analysis and software development for companies trading in the wholesale electricity markets. If you want any more information about what John actually did, you'll have to ask Lee. She gave me all these notes. I barely know what I'm talking about. John was Datamorphics president and traveled widely as a desirable consultant in that very specialized field. And in 2017, John went into the hospital with what he thought was pneumonia, but tragically, it was the ampullary cancer again, which had returned and metastasized. John held on to life fiercely, even as the over 5 years of on and off chemotherapy meant for him an early retirement and leaving behind the rigorous outdoor activities that he loved. John's life became small and then smaller when the COVID-19 pandemic swept the world in 2020. But he and Lee loved each other so deeply, it wasn't really so bad being stuck inside together. Lee reports that John got to see her work up close and personal for the first time thanks to remote Zoom work, and that he became even more impressed and amazed by her. John became weaker and weaker, but it was not until he was hospitalized at Mass General in mid-April of this year that he understood and accepted that he was dying. He said his goodbyes to many family and friends and died on April 21st, just a couple of days after his admission to MGH. Lee told me that John was seeking answers to the meaning of his life and his place in the universe through philosophy and science. And at the end of his life, he did wonder whether his memories and his existence would go on in some fashion. He told her he found some comfort in physics, like in Stephen Hawking's theory that data is stored around black holes. John hoped that his person would be stored somewhere, as nothing in the universe is created or destroyed. And to me, it's clear that he is at the very least stored in his family and friends' ongoing love and tightly held memories of who he was and what his life meant to them. John is survived by his beloved wife and partner of nearly 50 years, Lee Newman, his beloved nephew, Aaron Fox, three devoted aunts, numerous cousins, and countless friends, colleagues, and former students whose lives were changed for the better by John's presence. May indeed he live on in the memories, words, and deeds of those who knew and loved him. Amen.
Thank you.
I now invite forward John's wife, Lee Newman, to offer her reflection.
I want to thank all of you for coming today to remember and honor the memory of my husband, John Fox. John was the love of my life, soulmate, and best friend. And with him, I shared an incredible journey of almost 50 years, for which I will be forever grateful. I would like to take this time to talk to you about my relationship with John, to tell you about our life, to describe his character, to highlight his intellect, and to share some stories about his life. Joan Didion wrote a book entitled The Year of Magical Thinking. In it, she penned the phrase, "Life changes in the instant, the ordinary instant." This resonated with me because it described the condition under which the two most life-altering events of my life had occurred for me. The first was a fall day in September of 1973 when I met John, and a life of love, adventure, and hope was about to unfold. The second and most recent was the morning of April 21st when John slipped away from me forever. So let's start at the beginning of my life with John. I met John in the beginning of our senior year of studies at Indiana University. I had just moved into an apartment in Bloomington, Indiana, with three other women, including my younger sister, Lynn, and we were relaxing after a day of unpacking when there was a knock at our apartment door. It was the three guys from the apartment next door coming over to introduce themselves, and I think to check out their new female neighbors. I remember the day as if it were yesterday. I remember the room we gathered in. I remember where I stood in that room at the far end. I remember what John wore, his signature white fishnet tennis top, shorts, no socks, and plaid suede shoes. I remember how handsome he was and how interesting was the conversation and the topics he chose to speak about. I remember thinking, this is a very special person. At this gathering, I shared with the group that I was from South Bend, Indiana, and as such was an avid Notre Dame football team fan and would be watching the Notre Dame Michigan State playoffs the following weekend. Well, on the day of the game, 15 minutes before start time, there was a knock on the apartment door. Sure enough, it was John. He asked if he could watch the game with me. Of course, I said yes. And it was on this day that I fell in love with him, and he fell in love with me, and we became an inseparable pair, together then for almost 50 years, first as college sweethearts, then as young adults heading to college, and finally as adults supporting one another in our careers. And so my life changed that day in an instant, an ordinary instant. So who was this man I fell in love with on that September day and chose to spend my life with? How would I describe John? The attributes that come to mind are wise, smart, funny, kind, gentle, curious, and compassionate. He was an educator and a teacher. He was adored by me, his wife, and treasured by family and friends. But the core characteristics that I want to highlight this morning are his intellect, his engagement with life and ability to live it fully, and his being the person one could always count on to be present through life's most challenging times. So I begin with his intellect. John was an intellectually curious man with a thirst for knowledge. He was always reading and learning across a broad range of subjects. He was never satisfied to be told an answer to a topic and always had to investigate it himself. For John, education and learning were part of the fabric of his daily life. In the multiple numbers of books and papers he read, the lectures he gave and attended, and his unending questions. He was forever a teacher. He would take complex subjects and reduce them to a framework a non-scientist could understand. There were numerous times I would wake up in the middle of the night at 1 or 2 in the morning to find him out of bed and in his study, working on a new mathematical concept, or the times he was in the restaurant explaining to me his ideas on the back of a paper placemate. Even when we were young and in graduate school and money and resources were tight, John, whenever we had any additional funds, would head straight to the Coop or one of the bookstores to buy more books. I used to tease him that it was a good thing they had developed computers, or we probably would have needed addition to our house to house his library. John was also a forever learner. Toward the end of his life, he took courses at the University of California in their online graduate school program in bioinformatics. He was interested in understanding better how mathematics and data science tools were being used in the biology field. Taking this course was not related to his job or his career, but was just a reflection of how he had an intricate interest in the world around him. John was truly one of the most alive people I have ever met. He was a person who lived his lifespan fully with unbounded energy, always seeking out new and exciting experiences. When we first moved to Boston in 1975, he made it his mission to explore New England, and we spent time on the Cape, in New Hampshire, in Vermont, in Maine. Early on, we took up hiking. One of the first trips was in the White Mountains, where John had planned a trip up the Crawford Path Trail to the summit of Mount Monroe, I believe. Being from the Midwest, this was to be our first mountain climbing experience. I remember hiking to tree line and setting up camp for the night. In the morning, we awoke to a dense fog. I was somewhat intimidated by the weather, but we climbed up the trail for a while before we approached a sign which said, "Many have died here. If the weather is bad, turn back." At that point, I was ready to head back down the mountain. But with the fog beginning to lift, John convinced me to go forward to the summit. I was glad he pushed me outside of my comfort zone. The views were breathtaking, the experience exhilarating. We would go on to climb many more mountains and to take up skiing and biking as well, largely on his initiative. In the mid-1980s, John took up sailing, which activity was to become one of his passions. Coming from the Midwest, sailing had not been a skill set he had learned as a youngster. So he joined the Boston Sailing Center and learned to sail initially a J-24 and then a CNC-40. With this passion came connection and long-term friendships with other like-minded sailing-oriented people. We participated in group sailing trips along the New England coast from Maine to Buzzards Bay, in the British and American Virgin Islands, and passages to St. Lucia and to the Grenadines. John just loved to captain a boat. Generally, we sailed with other experienced people, as I did not trust my skill set and never wanted to be in a situation where I was in charge, were he disabled. But we broke this promise or pattern of sailing once, and that was in a sail from Boston through Scituate to P-Town. The sail over to P-Town was easy. There was no wind on the pond. And I thought, this is not bad. I can manage this. But as the week progressed in P-Town and the weather deteriorated, I became anxious. On the day of our return sail to Scituate, storm warnings were out and the wind was howling at 30 knots. John reefed the sail, laid the jack lines, and secured the harness connections for the return sail. Me, I checked the bus schedule for a return trip to Boston by land. But once again, John pushed me outside of my comfort zone. and we enjoyed an exhilarating sail across Cape Cod Bay. On the other side of the bay, the harbor master greeted us at the entry to Scituate Harbor, and he said, "What's it like out there? Not many boats out today." I said, "I thought, no kidding." John made all these experiences possible for us because of his sense of adventure and because of his love for learning. He acquired the skills necessary and developed the confidence required to engage in these activities successfully. He wanted to live life fully, and he did. As they say, he left nothing on the table. I was truly lucky to have had my life enhanced and expanded in this way. John was a person one could always count on to be present through life's most challenging times. When John's father, Wally, had a stroke in 2008, and his second wife, Donnie, died shortly thereafter, John moved his father from Indianapolis to Boston and oversaw his care for the next 8 years. When my mother fell and broke her hip in 2015 and could no longer live independently, John supported me in moving my mother to our home in Concord, where she lived for 2 years, and then on to North Hill, where she resides currently. When John's aunts in Indianapolis experienced challenging medical conditions, John was the person they contacted for advice and support that was always lovingly given. He was always ready to hop on a plane and head to Indianapolis at a moment's notice when others in the family needed him. In the early 1900s, John reached out to his brother's ex-wife because he was interested in having a relationship with his nephew, Aaron, who lived out of state. So he made plans to fly Aaron from St. Louis to Boston so that he could spend time to visit us, and summer vacations in particular. I remember the first visit that Aaron made to Boston in particular. This cute boy, now 47, Aaron, arrived in Boston with skateboard in hand, and John, very much wanting to be the best uncle, took Aaron sailing in Boston Harbor, skin diving at Folly Cove, and skateboarding throughout Boston and much of Quincy Market. The two bonded during that first trip. Aaron often described John as the cool uncle who drove the RX-7 sports car and listened to REM tapes. Over the years, there were many more trips to Boston, and consequently, many shared experiences. But life changes in the instant, the ordinary instant. And so then again, on the morning of April 21st, my life and our family's life forever changed in an instant, an ordinary instant, when John slipped away from all of us forever. I would like to close now by speaking to John directly. John, since you left, I have been able to feel your presence everywhere. And I know deep in my heart that you are never far from me. As you know, I had always hoped that I would never have to experience this type of loss and pain. Remember, we so often jokingly promised each other that I would be the first one to die because it would be harder for me to live without you. But here we are today with me left behind to continue life without you. Even so, this enormous divide has not changed our deep love and affection for one another. Although I have an ache in my heart knowing that I will never experience your physical presence again, I receive comfort in knowing that you are now incorporated inside of me. John, you gave me a wonderful life filled with love,
friendship, adventure, and intellectual growth. You gave me a light into your sweet soul, which I feel blessed to have seen and shared. I love you and miss you. My heart will always be with you, your Lee.
Thank you so much, Lee. I now invite forward John's cousin, Donna Reed, to offer a reflection penned and submitted by their cousin, Mark Pratt.
Hi, it's our pleasure to be here and our pleasure to pay honor to our cousin John. Maya Angelou quote has always been, "I've learned that people will forget what you said, people will forget what you did, but people will never forget how you made them feel." John had a calming voice and a way of making you always feel a sense of comfort when speaking with him. John always supported education and learning from a very young age. He took my cousin Mark to sign up for kindergarten and always shared his line of, "Get the best education you can and never stop learning. An education is something no one can ever take away from you." John was always off learning for the most of our childhood, but always made it home for the holidays. You will probably hear this and already have heard this many times today. This was a time that John was able to catch up with the family. He loved this time of the year and coming back to Indianapolis. He made it a point to work his way around the room to speak to everyone and have a meaningful conversation about what each of us have been doing, as well as share what new adventures he has had, including sailing, writing new software for some operating systems of the future. And we are all honored that he was able to touch our children as adults as well. All in all, John remained a pillar for us all, someone we all looked up to and we could all count on to be there, and just as calming as his voice. We will all miss him dearly, but we will always have him in our hearts, as well as his lovely wife, Lee, who is forever welcome to come to celebrate Christmas in Indianapolis with our family, the family. And they both, as they both did for many years. May God bless John, Lee, and everyone here celebrating his life. Cheers to the amazing, kind, loving soul John was to everyone he met. Thank you.
Thank you, Donna. I now invite forward John's friend, Dennis O'Connor, to offer his reflection.
I first met John in the mid-90s. I can't recall a specific meeting, but in all my favorable memories, John is in most of them. I do know that at the time we met, we were of similar skill and experience and especially enthusiasm. We sailed together many day trips, and even harbor sales, meeting and enjoying more and more people. One of those people was a lovely young woman. Her name is Janine. You've heard the term wingman. John was my wingman. Just about every time I had a boat reserved, I would invite Janine out. And since she always loved to go, I firmly heard a yes very often. John is my wingman, would also reserve boats and invite Janine along. The obvious goal here was to get her to say yes often enough that when I invited her out to dinner and her show, she would say yes without thinking. Weren't we clever? I'd be remiss if I didn't mention Scott Fitzgerald, who is the dean of the weeknight midweek sailing trips. We eventually planned a multi-boat weekend cruise. In preparation for this, anybody that's been on a boat and boaters knows that they do not like to go straight when they're in reverse. So, fearing the ultimate embarrassment of crashing into a dock in a strange port, John and I reserved a cruising boat for several nights and just went out into the mooring field and just backed down on all the different mooring balls. I'm sure up in the office, they were looking out there and saying, what is with these two don'ts? You're supposed to go forward with the pointy end. We eventually got down to actually planning the trip. We got our harbor charts, nautical slide rules and parallel rules and compasses, and we laid out the plan with every buoy on our trip, the course to it, its latitude and longitude. And I guess it's reasonable knowing that we're going to the far off port of Salem, Massachusetts. It must be at least 10 or 15 miles for those of you who are not familiar with the area. We left on a Friday night and sailed out to Petticks Island, which is one of the Boston Harbor Islands, and anchored behind it. And after a barbecue and a few drinks, the discussion came up of whether or not our anchor was dragging. So the discussion went on, we had a few more drinks, and then there was another discussion about whether or not the anchor was dragging. Ultimately, everybody settled down and we went to sleep and woke up in the same spot, and we set off on our trip. And the only issue was copious amounts of snoring through the night. Now, there's been debate over the years as to whether I did most of it or whether it was John. But I can tell you one thing, he was always able to fall asleep quicker than me. We did finish that trip without further incident. And one of the other things that we enjoyed were the nighttime sailing in Boston Harbor. And at that time, the harbor sails were included venues like the Harbor Lights music tent that was just off the pier down to where the courthouse is now, very close to the sailing center. Well, we decided one night that we'd go down there and we're going to fire out the barbecue and cook some ribs and probably cause a few more jealous stares from the people that actually paid big money to see these named artists. So we took our two boats out and anchored, fired up the grill, but one of our crew was still not there. It was going to be late, so we asked that the launch driver bring him out at some point, which he eventually did. But as other boats from the sailing center were coming back from their evening sail, the grill was going, the ribs smelled delicious, and they started circling us like sharks. Several of them were tied up alongside, and we had, I don't know how many people throughout the night came and they went. And there were all sorts of pictures being taken. And at the end of the night, we took them, we got them developed. And in almost every shot, here was the launch driver with a rib in his mouth. As our memberships increased, John and I both had the Cruising 40 membership, which allowed you to take any boat in the inventory. Now, part of the restrictions on those was you had a 1 week vacation in the peak season and a 1 week vacation in the off-peak season. And you had a 1 weekday and a 1 weekend day that you could have on the books at any one time. Well, it didn't take us long to break that code. John and I got together, and if we wanted to go to Provincetown on a 3-day, 4-day trip or anywhere else, one of us would reserve the boat Friday and Saturday, and the other one would reserve it for Sunday and Monday. No problem getting 4 days back to back. With the vacations, we did something similar. One of us would skipper the boat for 1 week, and the other would skipper the boat for the other week. Now, this allowed us to go to places like the upper coast of Maine and Booth Bay and New Hampshire, Cape Cod and the islands, and for 1 week, 2 weeks, it didn't matter. But in a situation like that, you have to really be able to trust the skills and the thinking of the person that you're sharing this with. And I never, ever had any qualms about sharing with John. On one of our trips up to Booth Bay, Maine, we sailed up one of the rivers in Casco Harbor to a little place called Snow Island. There's a little marina up at the top of the river there, and we pulled in and asked if we could take on some fresh water. And then the owner was very courteous and nice, and we also asked him if he sold lobsters. He said he didn't, and that we passed the lobster pound a couple miles back down the river. He said, oh boy, that's really kind of bad. He said, well, I'll tell you what. He says, if one of you want to come, I'll drive you down there. John jumped in his car, and off he went, and we dinghied back to the boat. When we came time to pick him back up again, he had these bags full of these Jurassic lobsters. They were huge. We had this big lobster pot to boil them in, and the most we could fit was two, and that was really squeezing them in there. Needless to say, everybody on the cruise had a delicious dinner that night. And even with the, we brought the crackers for the claws, wouldn't touch them. I had to go into my tool bag and fish out a pair of 12-inch channel locks. And if you don't know, that's like a great big set of pliers to be able to break the claws. Another time was on a return trip from the Cape Islands. We stopped in this little place called Hadley Harbor, which is just off the Woods Hole Institute. We had two boats rafted up, and everybody enjoyed a swim off of the back of the boats, then climbed back aboard to have a barbecue chicken dinner. Well, whoever attached the grill to the stern rail didn't quite tighten it enough, and that last drumstick, like the straw that broke the camel's back, just pivoted everything vertical. The charcoal, the chicken, and everything, we wanted for its own little swim at the end of the night. Now we're wondering what we're going to do. John said he had it covered. He went below decks and rummaged around, and before you know it, he came topside with what he called guy hors d'oeuvres, or Ritz crackers with cheese whiz. He took a sail tie, put it around his neck, and tied it like in a bow, like a bolo tie, and took the trays and just went around to the crews on both boats, serving them his guy hors d'oeuvres. Since both crews were sated, there was less possibility of immunity, and we made it back a little hungry, but nonetheless full of fun. Another one of my favorite moments. So we came back from a sail on the 40-foot Invictus. It was a breezy day. And at the time, they were keeping that boat in the marina next to the sailing center. Had these long, angled finger piers that were pretty spongy. They weren't all that solid. And we're coming in, and because it was breezy, you needed to tie the boat up pretty quickly. I was glad I had John with me, because he stood at the stern of the boat, and he had what we call a spring line that was going to attach to the end cleat on the dock. And when it was time, he jumped off the back of the boat and pivoted so he was facing me and the cleat he wanted to attach the line to. The dock compressed down to the water and sprung back up, and John looked like an Olympic diver going to the under the drink on the far side of the dock. I said, now, if you've ever skippered a boat and the one guy that you trust to get it tied up when you're coming in when you need it the most goes into the drink, it's reasonable to panic. However, just like the cut of a movie Deliverance, this forearm comes up out of the water with the dock line in its hand and takes a wrap around the cleat, boat secure. The only thing we had to do then is find them a shower to rinse off that harbor water. Our group of sailing friends continued to grow until we had our own real sailing center wrap pack. And that transitioned from summer sailing to winter ski trips to places like Okemo, Waterville Valley, Attitash, staying in rented villas with multiple bedrooms. Like sailing, these usually evolved into marathon hearts games, which became a staple for us whenever the weather turned sour or whatever, we'd get below and then the hearts cards come out. The culmination of our many sailing experiences were our many trips to charter sailboats in the Caribbean. There were multiple trips to the British Virgin Islands, where Vernon tried to teach those northeastern people how to sailboard. That was a sad experience. And finally, what we call our millennial cruise in 2000. That was a cruise where we were sailing down to begin our cruise in St. Lucia, and we were staying at a resort called Ladera that was about 15 feet up, 100 feet up the mountainside, had just three walls on every villa, with a little stone wall and a plunge pool that looked right over the Pitons. What a way to start a trip. And just before we left, I had proposed to Janine. Had a habit. Said yes. That day, John lost his job as my wingman, but he said yes to be my best man. Thank you.
with grief in our hearts at John's loss, yet joy for all the happy times we shared with him, we pause together for a moment of quiet when we can reflect, remember, and rejoice that John was a part of our lives. Amen. I invite forward John's sister-in-law, Diane German, to offer our benediction adapted from writer Merritt Malloy.
Now, what do we do with our sadness and our enduring loss? To that point, Lee chose this poem, Epitaph by Merritt Malloy, for me to read because she felt it represented John's voice. If he were to speak today at this gathering, he would say, "When I die, if you need to weep, cry for someone walking on the street beside you. And when you need me, put your arms around others and give them what you need to give me. You can love me most by letting hands touch hands and souls touch souls. You can love me most by sharing your celebrations and multiplying your good deeds. You can love me most by letting me live in your eyes and not on your mind. And if you say prayers for me, remember what your theology teaches. Love doesn't die, people do. So when all that is left of me is love, give me away."
Thank you all for participating in this service of remembrance today. John's family welcomes all who are here in Needham to a luncheon reception in our parish hall, out the door to your left and down the hallway, where you can stay and share stories or take a lunchbox to go. But before the postlude begins, I ask that you remember to take care of yourselves and to take care of each other in the coming weeks and months. The first year without a loved one is very hard on the family and on close friends, especially at birthdays, holidays, and during sailing season. There is now a hole in the fabric of your lives, one that will never be closed. I'm sure you've already experienced the moments when you think to yourself, "I should tell John that," or "John would love this," only then to remember that he has died. There will be times like those when you fall into the hole of grief and feel quite sad. Over time, you will learn where the hole is that John once occupied, and then you will not ignore your loss or fill it in, but you will anticipate when grief will come upon you and the memories will not be as tinged with sadness and longing. Then when you encounter the hole in the fabric of your life, you will be able to remember with bittersweet gratitude the blessings that John gave you. But before that time has come and grief is still fresh, take care of yourselves and take care of each other. Please now remain seated for the postlude and join the family in the parish hall after.